Tonight we are in the mountains of Colombia's west coast, and we are looking for Diplodocus monotropus, better known as the rainbow lizard or the rainbow gala wasp. And this lizard is definitely a favorite of mine. They're not super easy to find, but we'll see what we can do. We have a very nice praying mantis species on this branch here. This one is in the genus Acanthops. My first time seeing a male, actually. This genus that this mantis belongs to, Acanthops, contains about 20 species, all of which are found in the Neotropics, and it was first described in 1831. Collectively, they're known as dead leaf mantises, and the males in this genus, like the one that we have here, are most often encountered around lights at night. These dead leaf mantises have some pretty extreme sexual dimorphism. The females are not at all flattened like the males are, and instead have a raised abdomen that looks like a curled or folded dead leaf. Of course, both males and females are highly cryptic, but it seems that the males are meant to mimic leaf litter, while the females might mimic a dead twig or part of a branch. And unlike the males, the females are completely flightless, and they also feign death when they're disturbed. As you can see here, this one does have pointed eyes. This is something that the entire genus is known for. Our first Diplodocus is poking out of these dead palms on the ground here. You can see his head poking out there, and it might be difficult to catch. Oh boy. Here he is. I think this first gala wasp that we've caught is a male, but I can't be too sure because the thickness of the tail near the cloaca is somewhat unreliable in this instance. Diplodocus monotropus is a species that was described in the early 1800s. It's found in southern Nicaragua, Costa Rica, Panama, northwestern Colombia, and western Ecuador. Quite a few species that are found in the Choco rainforest share a similar distribution. And throughout this range, they inhabit a variety of forests from about sea level to 1,000 meters in elevation. Like I said at the beginning of the video, these are quite secretive. They spend a lot of their time in burrows, underground debris, or inside of rotting fallen logs. This is one of only two species of gala wasps known from Colombia. The other one is Diplodocus millipunctatus from Malpelo Island, and that means that this is the only mainland gala wasp found in Colombia. Unsurprisingly, in this area, this is one of the most brightly colored lizard species, but fully matured males are even more colorful than the one that we're looking at right now. The most prominent difference is that on the dorsal surface of adult males' heads, the color is almost completely bright yellow, something that you'll only see in smaller juveniles. When they're young, they often start out with these light blue rings around their tail. We have a Transandean coral snake hidden away in these leaves. It's quite convenient that we were able to find this coral snake here. I'll explain why if we're able to find another rainbow lizard. This snake is a subspecies level taxon, known by the name Micrurus dumarili transandinus. It's called the Transandean coral snake because the mountains that it lives in are associated with the Andes. For this species, that's the western slope of the Andes in Ecuador, Colombia, and a little bit of Panama. But still, as a group, all dumarili subspecies are found around the Andes. At the species level, these range as far east as western Venezuela. And this is the most common coral snake here. I've probably seen about 10 or so in total. Like many coral snakes, these feed on snakes, worms, and Sicilians. Recently, I was able to observe this coral snake species feeding on a coffee snake, specifically Ninia terracidae. It took a while for the coral snake to eventually get to the head of the coffee snake. And for a good portion of the time that it took to do this, it appeared that the coffee snake was still alive. We have a large Acanthotis curvidens on this trunk here. This is a species that I have some experience with, and I'm not going to catch it because these hop everywhere, and they also have the ability to fly. This genus was described in 1831, and it contains six species, all of which are distributed throughout Central America and Northern South America. This species is found in Costa Rica, Panama, Colombia, and supposedly Venezuela as well. This identification is not 100% because I'm pretty sure the Choco region for Acanthotis is not fully resolved. You can tell this one is quite a good lichen mimic. That's what the genus is known for, but their daytime behavior is also interesting. These have a way of tucking in their legs and flattening their body up against a trunk to completely conceal their outline for predators. These two things are characteristic of all species in this genus, not just this one. This one is an adult male, and this is about as large as they get. Males in this genus have some pretty interesting looking reproductive organs, quite unlike any other I've seen on other Orthoptera. Little else is known about their biology. Not too much to say about the species. Back here on this plant, we have a small Diasporus cuditis. That is a small little frog. These frogs in the genus Diasporus are commonly known as dink frogs or hammer frogs, but Diasporus quadratus does not have a common name for itself. This is a species that was described quite recently, in 2001, and it might be the smallest species of frog that lives around here. It might also be the whitest frog species that lives around here, and I think these white Diasporus quadratus might be a local variant, because normally it seems that these are a yellowish-brown color, and these are definitely one of the more common species of frogs that we have around here. They're listed as least concern by IUCN, but they don't have too large of a distribution. They're found from central Panama to western Colombia, mostly in the Darien and Choco regions. This species does not appear to be associated with moving water. Meanwhile, I believe most species of Diasporus are. And like the one we found, these are typically a meter or less above the ground. This is our second and final Diploglossus monotropus. No clip of me catching this one because it was not caught by me. You can tell that this one is a little bit more drab than the last one that we saw, and that leads me to believe that this could possibly be a female. Not too sure though. This is a species that forages on the ground. As I was alluding to earlier, it does have a highly terrestrial or fossorial lifestyle, and what these are eating out here are crabs, snails, and insects that they find on the ground. These lizards are the subject of many myths, especially in rural communities in the jungle where these lizards are found, and three of these myths stand out as the most common. The first one is that these are venomous, and this is a misconception that has affected many galla wasp species, not just this one, and causes people to kill them. These are also thought to give birth to coral snakes, which is what has earned them the name Mother Coral in Spanish in a few of the countries that they are found in. Finally, one of the other names that these are known by in Spanish is scorpion. The reason for this is that many also think that they can sting with their tail. Of course, while none of this is true, they do have a fairly strong bite. They are capable of drawing blood, but it's nothing too bad. Their other primary defense is autotomy, which they are especially prone to, along with other diploglossids. Those will be all the rainbow lizards that we are going to see tonight. So hope you enjoyed, and thank you for watching.